Well, let's start with this. Our study is in the book of Jeremiah. And I think that this is an excellent example of what I mean. I think that the loss of the kingdom is a very difficult concept for people to understand. And yet it's central to the Old Testament, or what we call the Hebrew Scriptures. This song, "There Is a Balm," comes from the book of Jeremiah. The question is raised, is there no balm in Gilead? Is there no way in which people can be healed from the hurt, the sorrow that they are feeling as a result of the loss of the kingdom? And the question, of course, is not answered in the biblical text. But it is interesting that African Americans, in their development of the spirituals, turn the question around and say, yes, there is a balm. And the balm that they are referencing is Jesus. So they have moved all the way into the New Testament to answer this question of the old. Nothing wrong with that. That's still a good move. But nonetheless, there are many issues around the loss of the kingdom which people seem not to understand. So let's explore that for a minute. You remember David and his son Solomon, right? You remember that David wanted to build God's house. You remember that? And you remember that God said to him, you can't do it, right? Because of that mess you got into. You remember that mess? You got a little greedy, standing on the rooftops, looking at stuff that you had no business looking at. Somebody help me with this, huh? And you got carried away. You went. Not only did you take the woman, but you killed the husband. And now you want to build me. Can't happen. Can't do that. But in that same conversation, God says to David, you can't build me, the Hebrew is a beit. You cannot build me a house, but I will build you a beit. And when God says it, he means a dynasty that will be eternal. And so this conversation becomes the beginning of what's called royal theology. This idea that as long as the kingship is there, and as long as the temple is there, everything is all right. Now, you can begin to see that for 400 years, this was the case. Because Solomon, David is 1000 BC. In this context of Jeremiah, we're talking 597 BC and 587 BC, and more specifically 87. But the point is, 400 years has passed, they have believed this word, they have believed this theology, and now Babylon has risen, and Babylon has come in 597 and taken all of the golden vessels from the kingdom, from out of the temple. Babylon has taken the king, Jehoiachin, and all of the royal family away into exile, many of the priests as well. And so now this situation, the context, is one of perplexity, one of fear, one of uncertainty. So when we begin to look at this context in depth, there are certain social, can we call them social indicators of their time? For example, Nehemiah is preaching, and there's some question among commentators as to whether or not Jeremiah was a good preacher or a bad preacher. Have you heard that? Some people say he was a bad preacher. They say he was inadequate. He really wasn't a good preacher at all. But you know what? I have a pastor in back in Minnesota, Dr. Miller Grant Battle. And Dr. Battle says, dogs don't bark at parked cars. In other words, if you're not doing anything, folk are not concerned about you. But if you're trying to accomplish something, if you're trying to get something done, if you're going somewhere, it's amazing the resistance that just comes out of nowhere. So if Jeremiah was preaching so hard that they arrested him, it wasn't because he couldn't preach. It was more likely that he was a very effective preacher. And the issue is this. Is God going to save the temple? Is God going to save the kingship? Or is God going to allow something else to happen? And if we have believed for 400 years that just as long as the temple exists and the king is on the throne, everything will go forward, and now the king has been removed, the golden vessels have been taken away, the very symbols of our stability have been thrown into question, we're really talking about 487. Are we talking about 487? Are we talking about, 587. Are we talking about 587, or are we talking about now, where the primary narrative that we have believed all of our lives gets thrown into question? I really thought I knew what it meant to be a man. I'm discovering I don't. I really thought I knew what it meant to be a woman. Not personally, but you know what I'm saying? From the other side of the coin, I thought I really understood what it meant. But there's some questions that are being raised about fundamental issues that we thought were settled and unmovable. And it isn't so much always about the things themselves, the temple or the man, the woman. It isn't so much about that. But what's really disturbing is when you feel like you thought you knew God. I'm by myself on that. I know I am. But I thought I knew God. But now I'm getting the sense that maybe God is maybe I don't know. Maybe there's some things that I thought. That's the context. It is a time of uncertainty. It's a time of questioning everything, even questioning who God is and what God is going to do in their lives. Certain social indicators, those things that are point to the time in which we exist. One is that there was prophetic preaching, and we talked about that. Jeremiah was a prophetic preacher. I want to say that he was a prophetic preacher in the order of Martin Luther King. Anybody remember when King was around? Can I tell a story? Who is my timekeeper? I need an official timekeeper. Someone who always watches the clock anyway. I don't want somebody to take this up as a new. Don't start today. I want my original time. Yes, sir. Somebody who always watches the clock. Yes, sir. Give me, what time is it now?
9:16.
Okay, and so I have till 40, right?
40?
As in
9:40? 10.
9:45.
You got till 10.
Yes, 9:50. So at 9:45.
Okay.
9:45. Signal to me. Act like you got happy. And I will know that that is the deal, right? Okay, so I'm going to tell the story real quick. So this is about King. In our house, it was shaped like an L. And my room was on the back end of the little thing that made it look like an L. The rest of the house was this. Anyway, so when King would speak and be on the evening news, I'd be in my room doing something. My mother would be cooking the dinner in the far end of the house, and my father would be in the den. And my father would yell out to my mother, "Bernie," that was her name, "Bernie, King is on." The fire would go out under the food wherever I was. I would drop what I was doing. We would run into the family room and get next to the TV and listen to every syllable that he said. Because it was clear that he was a prophet. Anybody, you really remember him? I mean, there was what we call in the black church an anointing. There was an anointing on him that when he spoke, you knew not only was he speaking, you knew that the forces of God, the forces of the Spirit were speaking at the same time. So, Jeremiah was that kind of preacher. You knew God was speaking. The problem becomes the fact that not only is he a prophetic preacher, but he is a prophetic preacher under the threat of assassination. That's a social indicator. That's a little different. You're not just preaching, but folks want to kill you over what you are saying. Also, another social indicator is the laments that are in the book of Jeremiah. The laments are there because life is not all joy. Life is pain and sorrow. And the laments are there to help us deal with and express the pain and sorrow that's there. And it's interesting because it also parallels the civil rights movement in as much as there were the songs that were, the spirituals that were sung during that period of time. And they were laments in a way that talked not only about the conditions in which they found themselves, but their hope for greater tomorrow. So I'm hopeful that as we look at this, I'm hopeful that we will come to a place to understand the beauty of the biblical text is that there are always biblical horizons which match the horizons in which we live and the times in which we live. And I want to suggest to you that the book of Jeremiah is one of those times. The other thing about the book is this. It is not written in chronological order, which makes it really difficult to put together. It's really a scattered kind of writing, disjointed kind of writing. Doesn't really follow a timetable, regular timetable or anything. And it's done intentionally, it is suggested, because it gives us the feeling of uncertainty and disruption that the people felt at the very time in which this is discussed and talked about. There are also a couple of conversations that are important that happen in this time that give us a sense of the context. In the, somewhere around 27, 28, chapter 27, 28, 29, there is a conference that appears to be being held by all of the minor states, nation states, that are threatened by Babylon's power. They seem to get together, or their ambassadors seem to get together. And in this meeting, there are two major prophets who begin to speak about whether the kingdom will be preserved or whether something else is going to happen. One prophet, Hananiah. Second prophet, Jeremiah. Now, when we read our biblical text and we read other texts that are more current, shall we say, there is this idea that one is false and the other is true. But if you go back to the original text, Septuagint, you discover that this is not the case. That there was never a discussion of a false or true. But rather that both prophets were respected in the same way. In fact, they had the same identical prophetic formula. When they got ready to say what God was saying, they would both say, "Thus saith the Lord our God of Israel." So it's hard to tell who was the true prophet and who was the false. Hananiah suggested that even though the temple's vessels had been taken, that in short order they were going to be brought back to Jerusalem. And that the king, even though he had been taken into exile, would somehow be brought back to Jerusalem. And all was going to be well. Jeremiah, interesting response, doesn't contradict him, but he says, "That sounds like peace. I'm for peace. May it be the way you say that it is." And he goes away. Conference is over. A little time later, Yahweh comes to Jeremiah and reveals again what is really going to happen to Jerusalem and to Judah. And so then Jeremiah goes back to Hananiah and says to him, "God never invited you into this conversation. You are meddling in other folks' business. And since you're meddling, and since you were never asked to be involved, I'm going to remove you permanently." And so by the end of the year, Hananiah is dead. I mention that because many of us have been subjected to false prophets, particularly around the issues of sexuality. And maybe not even intentionally. You know, I don't think Hananiah was a bad guy. I think he just wanted to see some good come out of the deal and felt he might help God. Anybody ever tried to help God? I know I have. I have many times tried to help God when I got in situations and I felt like God needed my help. I can see very clearly it was my help that was needed. Hananiah was just simply trying to help God and to say that these things were going to be all right. Jeremiah, patient, waiting yet again, even though he already knew it had been prophesied to him or spoken to him many times, he already knew what was going to occur. And yet he waited again for the affirmation of God. We have been subject to false prophets who have, in an attempt to help God, maybe not even maliciously, allowed our cultural understandings, our social understandings, to influence our theological understandings, our biblical understandings. It's been been a difficulty for me. I never understood how it is we thought we could discriminate against anybody as Christians. I'm not talking about folk in the world, I'm talking about us. How did we think we could? Somehow, somehow pick out a certain group of folk and say that they are less than. Or somehow God's love does not extend to them. The beautiful thing that we do is that we say, oh, those of us who are really good Christians and really pious, we say, we love the individual, but we hate the sin. Well, that sounds good for a while, but when you break it down, it's not really the sin that you hate. You hate what they do or what you think they do. And it's disgusting to you. It is against your principles. It's against your sense of attraction. It's repulsive. And it becomes difficult to determine what we truly dislike. And I could never figure out why the love of God was not supreme in these discussions. How do you get away from the love of God? Oh, I don't ever want to get away from the love of God. Do you know how much I need the love of God? You don't even know me, but you need to know that I need the love of God. I need it. And to even think that somehow there was something that I could do that would put me outside of the love of God frightens the hell out of me. Or even more importantly, who am I to say that you are outside of? What do I know that would even allow me to say that? My theory is this, that there is a down-low relationship between gay people and God. You know what the down-low is? I'm talking for maids. Now they don't know the down low. If the young people were here, they could tell you about the down low. The down low is when you're hiding stuff. It's all called on the DL, on the down low. In a heteronormative example, the down low is I got a girlfriend over here. I'm married over here. I know that nobody here has ever experienced that. I know that. But it happens in the world. And my relationship over here with the woman over here, that's the down low. That's right, I'm on the down low. I don't want anybody to know that that's going on. Nobody's sitting on the down low. Well, same thing in gay relationships, right? They're on the down low. They don't want anybody. I'm suggesting that there is a down low relationship between gay people and God. You don't know about it. You don't know anything about it. And yet it exists. It exists because you cannot be so ostracized in the way that they are ostracized. And you cannot be so penalized and so discarded and discriminated against and not seek a higher power to empower you to live day to day. That's why the suicide rate among gays, young gays particularly, is so high. Because they feel so oppressed by the society. But we don't know who God is in relationship with. And God doesn't need our permission to be in relationship with other people that we don't know about. And so this is the context. This is the time in which we live, and it is the context in the book of Jeremiah. Questions? Concerns? Then let's proceed. There were a number of people who were angry with Jeremiah. One group in particular was the princes of Judah. They were particularly angry. They felt there was a specific difficulty that he was adding to as to why they wanted him to stop preaching, or they wanted him to put him where other people could not hear him. Their concern were the guards. Their concern was the army. Those men and men primarily who were in the army of Judah, who were trying to defend, who were in a position to try to defend the city against the Babylonians. They're standing there at their post, doing their job, and Jeremiah begins to preach, the only way to be saved is to leave this environment and to move into Babylon. And so now this is counter to the work that the soldiers are doing. And so the princes of Judah go to the king. And they say to him, let's throw this guy. Let's kill him. Let's kill him. Now imagine that. They had never killed a prophet. Judah never. Israel, they don't kill prophets. It's not what they do. They've got strict instructions not to do that. And they're advocating that they just kill him. So they go before the king. And Zedekiah, who had been appointed king by Nebuchadnezzar, is in a very awkward position himself. This may never have happened to you, but it's not always good to be appointed by somebody to replace somebody else that they wanted out of the way. Has that ever happened to anybody in your life? They chose you. They didn't really want you. What they really wanted was the other person to be gone, but they chose you. And that's who Zedekiah was. He was in the lineage, but he was so far along in the lineage that he probably never ever would have been chosen to be king. But he was probably non-threatening, right? And Nebuchadnezzar probably understood that he was not a threat of any kind. So he points to the king. So when the princes get mad and they want to kill Jeremiah, they go before the king. And Zedekiah says, do what you gotta do. Because I have no power, really. I can't contend against you. If you want to kill, do it. So they think for a while, okay, if we kill it, the blood will be on our hands. How can we kill him and not let the blood be on our hands? Someone comes up with the bright idea. Put him in the cistern. Don't give him any water. Don't give him any bread. Put him in the cistern. And that's what they do. They lower him down into this cistern full of mud. And he is stuck in the mud. It is a difficult thing to deal with change that is brought upon us that we did not initiate. And it is a difficult thing to deal with the will of God when it is against what we want. But let us not kill people. Let us find another way to resolve our are we talking about 587, or are we talking
2015?
Let us not kill. So, next week we'll talk about getting Jeremiah out of the pit. But that's where he is right now. Questions? I want to suggest to you that we are on the cusp of great change in our nation. And that our real difficulty is the dismantling of the larger narrative that we have believed in, that was never really completely true, never without fault. A part of that narrative, a big part of that narrative, is patriarchy. And patriarchy has been adopted in a very strong way by white males, which I'm not, but I'm identifying with the male part. And as a result of that, we view women in a certain way. Or so we thought we could view women in a certain way. But that's being challenged. We viewed people of color in a certain way. And that's being challenged. But the interesting thing to me about the black church is that it has always understood that we live in very different worlds. People of color and people who are living with white privilege, be they male or female. Very different worlds. In my research, as I put this dissertation together, I found a 1929 article in a major black paper I was in Abyssinia Baptist Church in New York studying the 65-year reign of Adam Clayton Powell and Adam Clayton Powell Sr., his father. The father pastored for a number of years, then the son took over. The whole lineage, whole ministry was like 65 years, beginning somewhere prior to the turn of the 20th century. There was a letter that Adam Clayton Powell had written to Booker T. Washington. You guys know who Washington was? And he was, and it was an unclear letter. He was talking about some incident that had happened, but it really wasn't clear what the incident was. And this is dated around 1929. So I really get intrigued by this, and I start going to the papers to see if we can find out what happened. Here's the story. Booker T. Washington was on the streets of New York in about 1929, and the Irish cops who ran New York, probably still have some major influence, spotted him, and he got into an altercation with the police. They beat him down on the street. 1929. Which means what we think is a major issue today, it's been going on. It's been going on forever. I say that to say that the pressure that is against the dominant narrative that we are operating, or we have operated on, needs to be brought into question. It is essential that it's brought into question. And though it gives us uncertainty, it is something that we have to face. At the turn of the century, which is when this happened, 1929, just before the stock market falls, the two major African-American male leaders in the nation are Booker T. Washington in the South, who has Tuskegee as an institution, and W.E.B. Du Bois, who is a graduate of Pastor Ann's School, Harvard, first African-American sociologist, recognized and beat down on the street. So that the mission of the Black church is a very different mission than the dominant church, mainline. It is different for a reason. It's not just different because we like to sing in a certain way or we like to pray, although that's a part of it. Nonetheless, it is different because the consciousness that is needed to be articulated to this people for their survival is different. So when I look at the book of Jeremiah, I look at it as a very positive book because I can see in it parallels to what I have experienced in life. There's a sense in which it is distinctively different. Because it ends in exile. It ends in marginalization. It ends in being denigrated in a way, diminished in a way. And so you can see why people who are experiencing that already in life would have no interest in this book. And yet, it is the mystery of God that God can take things that we would discard and speak to us in them. Am I still on time? What time is it?
43, two more minutes.
Pretty good, pretty good. And no questions. I like questions. I'm upset that there are no questions. I want you to go, your assignment. Your assignment, yes, you have a question.
How do we bridge that difference?
Excellent question. Talk to me about the difference you mean. How, your question is, how do we bridge that difference? I think in our society, the dominating culture, whites, the dominating group, has to understand that they have privilege and that they're exercising it every day. So it's important that's a beginning step, to be aware that privilege exists. Then to be able to recognize that domination is occurring. The enemy is not you and I. The enemy is domination, in whatever form domination shows up. If you have, I'm not talking about anybody because I don't know anything about anybody's marriage, okay? But let me use this example. If you have a dominating husband, to acknowledge that you are being dominated as a woman and that your capacities are being shut down by this guy is to understand that that's not the will of God concerning you. The will of God concerning you is that you be the greatest you that you can possibly be. The same principle operates around race. If you understand that the dominating culture is creating a constant situation whereby money is valued in a certain way, it's available here, but it's not available here, but because it's available for war, but it's not available for education. You see what I'm saying? So then you have to say, what would God would that everyone would be educated, would be developed to their fullest capacity, that there would not be barriers to their development. And the church, us, we need to be sure that we're trying to remove the barriers. That's the will of God concerning us. That when we have opportunity to impact the barriers, that we remove them. Yes?
I really appreciate what you said about recognizing that we have privilege because we are white or because we
right.
are male or female
right.
or whatever, and the domination thing. I think it's hard for many of us to recognize our privilege because look at us. We're all white in this room, I think, except you and me.
No, it's just you and just brothers yeah. and people that
I mean, there's a there's
yeah.
very few.
Right.
And the only way we can recognize our privilege, I think, is in relationship with people who are different from us, whether they be homosexual or non-Americans or non-Christians or non-white.
Right.
And it's hard to, I think it's, you know, I like the question about how you bridge this.
Yourself, right? And conveying to the people that you meet that there really is no difference from them, between them and you. You're not, you know, you've met people who were kind of snobby, right? Even other white people, to you. I mean, you know what I'm saying? This happened, right? Where other white people who felt they were better than you, right? For whatever reason. You know, they come out of their own money, shall we say, you know, as opposed to doing. But you got that right away. When you met them, that feeling, you got that right away. You knew exactly where they were coming from. I don't know what you said when you walked away, but I know what I said when I walked away. And you know? So you greet people so that doesn't happen, that is not present. You greet them with sincerity, you greet them openly, with love, saying, I fully recognize that others have treated you, I mean, just conveying this, not necessarily in words, but just in the way that you greet, in the way that you engage them. I fully recognize that other folks have treated you in a different way, but that's not how I'm going to treat you. I'm going to treat you like you are my brother, my sister, because that's who you are to me. That's how I see you. The genuineness of that is what comes across.
Well, and I think also acknowledging that their feeling may be quite different about, I may see someone who's different from me as equal, but I also need to be aware that their perspective may be quite different.
That's right.
Because their life experience is different.
Life experience is different, absolutely. So, your assignment, any other questions? Questions, anyone? Your assignment is to go home and find a question. Come back. When you come back on next Sunday and we discuss getting Jeremiah out of the pit and the African guy who does this, who happens to be African and queer. That's who I'm going to introduce you to next year. African and queer. It's called intersectionality. It means you got more than one thing going on in your life that people can discriminate against you for. When you look at this passage that I laid out for you today and what's there for next week, let's make sure that you come back with a question, okay? Can we pray?